Welcome, everyone. Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, depending on where in the world you're tuning in from. I'm your host, Samantha Becker, and I'd like to welcome you to today's installment of the NMC Beyond the Horizon series, Digital Literacy Part 2. Before the new year, we had another group of panelists discuss various definitions and strategies of this topic, and today I'm joined by a new panel of thought leaders in this area who will be sharing their own unique perspectives on different facets of digital literacy, such as digital citizenship and digital literacy and democracy. It's going to be a really good time. But before we dive into the discussion, I just want to point out a few logistical notes. So there's several ways to interact with us and the panelists today. So the official hashtag for the Twitterverse out there for this event and for the Horizon Project in general is hashtag NMCHZ. So we encourage you to join the Twitter back channel. There's usually a lot going on there. And finally, today I'm joined by the NMC's Beyond the Horizon event series director, Alex Freeman, as well as NMC CTO, Gordon Jackson. All right, without further ado, I'd like to get the show on the road. It's my pleasure to introduce you to the moderator of today's discussion, our dear friend, Brian Alexander. So Brian, as many of you hopefully already know him, and probably do, is a futurist, a researcher, writer, speaker, consultant, teacher, working in the field of technology, deciphering how it transforms education. Throughout his business, Brian Alexander Consulting, he consults throughout higher education in the U.S. and abroad. Personally, I've had the pleasure of working with Brian for 6 years and co-authoring a recent digital literacy publication with him, and we are so lucky to have him here today. He'll also be introducing our esteemed panelists. So Brian, take it away.
Well, thank you so much, Sam. It's a real pleasure to be here. Greetings to everybody from around the world who's participating. Now, I just have a couple of quick things to say, and then I want to get things going. First, the way things are going to go today is we have a panel of wonderful people who are going to introduce themselves in just a second. I'm going to ask members of the panel questions. The questions are separate, but I think you'll find many connections and overlaps among them. There's a lot here. In fact, this is a rich topic. We've been carrying on this conversation for a while and plan on continuing through social media and perhaps subsequent programs. So keep an eye out for that. Now, again, just to reiterate what Sam said, this is an interactive conversation. So not only will the panelists be interacting with each other and myself, but also you have the option to ask us questions and to throw ideas our way. So use the Q&A box for questions, use the chat box for, well, chat, and on Twitter, we'll be monitoring the hashtag NMCHZ closely. Now, before we go further, let's just have each member of the panel introduce themselves. And why don't we start with Cheryl from South Africa?
Excellent. Hi, everybody. I'm Cheryl Brown. I'm from the University of Cape Town, which is right at the bottom of South Africa. I'm a lecturer and teach students in our postgraduate courses in educational technology. Yes, and my personal interest and passion is around digital literacy and digital identity.
Fantastic. Welcome. And we're so glad to take advantage of the expertise and passion today. And then also from Spain, we have Yves Prigny. Yves, why don't you say a few words about yourself?
Hello, good afternoon also from myself. So I am Yves Prigny. I am working for the European Commission, but based in Sevilla in the south of Spain. And actually, we are part of the in-house research centers of the European Commission. You could say the in-house research laboratory. So what we basically do is we do studies and reports on supporting European policies in many different areas. And obviously, in my area, it's the area of education and skills, and more particularly on the digital transformation of education and skills, and also how to address 21st century skills and competences. So we're working in the area of, you could say, evidence-based policymaking to support European policies and the member states in Europe to develop educational skills policies throughout Europe.
Excellent. We're so glad to see you here. We've got Europe, we have South Africa, and now we have the rogue state of Great Britain with our friend Helen Beetham. Helen, why don't you introduce yourself?
Thank you, Brian. So I'm Helen Beetham and I work in the UK on e-learning research and strategy. I have developed a digital literacy framework in that's quite widely used in the UK in education, and worked on a number of other framework projects, one of them with EVE in the EU, which has been a great honour. And I guess my passion is for digital literacy seen in the kind of broad context of citizenship and well-being.
Well, that's fantastic. We're really, really glad to see you here. We're really glad of all of you guys. And again, I also want to thank Gordon and Alex for being here, for doing such wonderful technical work. And I want to thank Sam for doing just fantastic cat herding work. Now, we have so much to cover, and I find that there are a lot of ways to dive into the question of digital literacy. And I want to cut at it from a different angle this time. I want to ask the panel, what does digital citizenship mean? And I want you to think about that in the context of a world that is both going through incredible amounts of globalization, but also through a new wave of anti-globalism. So when you think about the intersection of digital literacy, democracy, activism, and organization. So why don't we start off with, well, Helen, why don't you give us your thoughts?
Thank you, Brian. That's a huge question to open up with. I guess for me, when we talk about digital citizenship and activism and democracy, we'd be thinking of the kind of really positive aspects of that, the aspects that Mark Zuckerberg has quite recently blogged about on Facebook, that we have these new opportunities for coming together, for collective thinking and decision making, for collective kinds of activism, for those opportunities to be a citizenship in a way that maybe transcends national boundaries. And I think there are some things that are really positive and exciting about that vision. I also think that idea of the future as a kind of rolling digital focus group echoes quite in quite a difficult way for us in the UK, where we've just been through a very traumatic process of a referendum, where that was a kind of direct democracy, a kind of focus group, if you like, which was actually very undermining of many of our social institutions and values. I'm not talking about the result, I'm talking about the process that we went through. Uh-huh. And I think I would say that I would want to focus not just on the free choice to listen to messages I choose to, but I would think about issues of power and responsibility and how they play out in digital systems and how we support our students to come to understand themselves as actors in those spaces where the rule of law may operate, but also all kinds of other forces operate. So essentially online spaces are private spaces which are owned by corporations, but where we act as citizens in many respects. And that's very complicated. And for me, digital citizenship has to be helping our students to understand those spaces, media literacy, their data literacy, and their potential for activism.
That set of comments, I think, gives us an outline for an entire seminar, because this is that deep an issue. Everything from the specific political conditions of information in Britain to what it means to think about power and access online with all those intersecting forces. Okay, I want to put that there on the table and then ask Eve if Eve can address what's going on with the rest of Europe. How do you see your digital competence framework, say, addressing these questions of citizenship?
Okay, thanks, Brian. And also thanks, Ellen, for this beautiful introduction already. Just to highlight that indeed, I can definitely follow the notion that, you know, if you look at digital literacy, not to look at it from a very narrow kind of point of view, referring only to being able to, you know, use digital technologies, you know, it's not about technical skills, but it's really about being able to participate in our modern society. And maybe also an important concept related to that is empowerment. Being able, as a user, as a citizen, you know, to exercise your rights, your responsibilities also, but really to be able to fully participate in a digital society. Now, I think we should not be naive and assume that everybody will be, you know, fully actively participating in democratic processes, in citizen participation, etc. I mean, there will always be kind of a, you can call it a ladder of participation, in terms of you will always have a number of people who are more active than others. And just to highlight that, I think that's fine. That's no problem. I don't think from that point of view that the digital world is so extremely different than the analog world, where we also do not expect everybody to participate in democratic processes. But I do see in the digital world much more potential for including more people and give them a more active voice into citizen participation. I think that that's really, really important. You're also referring to the digital competence framework, but maybe I can come to that later, just not to dominate the discussion at this particular moment.
Very good. I appreciate that. And again, I really like how you link the physical to the virtual world, seeing many, many commonalities. Well, let's round out our panel here. And let's ask Cheryl. I mean, Cheryl, we spoke before about digital literacy and activism. Would you like to speak to that angle of citizenship?
Well, I think from our point of view, and I hear the word digital citizenship, I start to think about issues around equality and who's included and who's excluded in that. And certainly coming from South Africa, from a more developing context where access is a very, very real issue, we can't assume that everybody does have access to this world, that being a digital citizen is something that everybody necessarily has when they, especially when they arrive in the higher education sector in particular. So I think for me, it's got a lot to do with that. And I think it's also got a lot to do with how we think about it and the rhetoric we use in our sort of literature. And I think we have to stop ourselves and think about what it is that we're saying and think about what it is that we mean. So, I mean, I find the whole discussion around digital natives and digital immigrants really problematic in terms of the way it positions people into particular types based on age, and that conversation continues when you're thinking about other aspects of how people participate digitally in our society. So I think my framework for thinking about digital citizenship is really one that cautions us to actually just think about who's in and who's out, and then we can start to think about how we can enable equality of participation.
That's fascinating. Cheryl, it seems like you, actually all three of the panel, are really interested in this question of differentials of access, differentials of power, differentials of capacity, that not everybody has equal access to information and to political participation. I just want to say a couple words in response to my own question, which is, I think the greater skills a population has towards digital literacy means greater skills they have to use digital technologies to organize politically and socially. And we've seen that in everything from the Arab Spring to political movements in Britain and in the United States. And of course in South Africa, with a lot of unrest in South Africa and Quebec against increasing student fees. I think one outlier that we have to keep in mind is that digital literacy can lead to social unrest, or put another way, those who are unhappy with social situations can use digital literacy to organize. So our citizenship can become very, very active. But let's cut this in a different slice. Let's take all of our digital literacy ideas now, with our notions of power, our notions of access, of rhetoric and exclusion. Let's think about well-being. And we are still making the digital world. And it's still very much in process. What kind of digital society do we want to live in? I mean, in part, I'm asking you as political actors, members of different societies, but also in education, as we shape the small worlds of institutions, and through our students, shape the broader world. What kind of digital well-being would we like to see? And please, I don't want to point at individuals here, just first person who goes.
Well, I'll have a go at a couple of angles on that, Brian. I think it's great that you have highlighted the fact that digital well-being is not just for individuals. You know, education is not just an individual good, and nor is digital literacy. Although we tend to treat it in our frameworks and in our curriculum practices, though it is actually a question about what kind of digital society we want to live in. So I'm really grateful to you for highlighting that. I think if I could come at it from a slightly different angle, a few years ago I developed a digital capabilities framework which became, you know, somewhat used in the UK, and I was asked to update it about 18 months ago, and I did that through consulting with a lot of people who are educators and where I was able to with students as well. And some of the issues that came through that had not been there kind of in 2010 were around media and data literacy. I mean, media literacy was understood, but I think the prevalence of opinion-based news, information, what we might call alternative facts in the present time, wasn't really there. And back in 2010, many of us had this grand view of the internet as a kind of commons of public opinion, of public debate, as a kind of agora of free thinking. And there is now much more sense of concern, both about the inequalities of access, as you have said, not to the actual network and the connection and getting online, but to access of the, to the kinds of skills that might allow me the capital, that might give me some place to stand as these messages arrive with me. So I think that's something that educators absolutely have to provide. And I think the other, one of the other things that came through for me was the role of data and algorithms. So not just assuming that our students are likely to have jobs where they might have to manage a database and that that's the limit of our responsibility to them, but assuming that their well-being will depend on them understanding how algorithms define and create them as people within systems that they have no choice about participating in, or limited choice, about how the value of their work might well be monitored in digital systems. And you know, if they're one of the growing army of peace workers in kind of Uberized digital economies, then their work will be distributed to them through digital systems. So getting quite away from the whole data privacy issues, which are often there in the curriculum, and quite rightly so, there is a whole issue about the kind of work I'm likely to be doing, the kind of community data kind of penetrated community I'm likely to live in. And I think it's absolutely there in our sense of our responsibility as educators to understand for ourselves what this means. So we know we're not on a different page to our students. We're trying to understand for ourselves what this is like, what it means for us, what it means to act in that space. But it has to be there as a critical issue, I think, in everything we do.
That's fantastic. That's another very, very rich response, thinking about algorithms, thinking about access, thinking about the difference between the technological access and the social capital access. You've given us quite a range of tasks for educators to pursue. But how about Cheryl, how about Eve? Do you want to add to that?
I can add. I think there was a really interesting question in the Q&A about, what type of openness and access does this digital world lead to? And, are we really looking at really sort of low level debate and engagement, or are we looking at sort of higher order thinking online? And I think that's something that is really, really part of digital well-being. We have to learn how to teach our students, and we have to learn how, as educators ourselves, we can both give voice to people who haven't had voice previously. And I think that's one of the immensely empowering things about technology, and teach people how to do that appropriately. So it's not just as simple as skills and practices. We really have to teach people behaviors and ways of being online, and how to conduct themselves as individuals in an online world. I think it's both empowering in the fact that it sort of allows people from all over the world globally, when we're thinking about a very broad sort of, digital citizenship, for their voices to be heard. But it also allows people to say and do things that they wouldn't ever do in a face-to-face environment. And I think that also brings with it a whole lot of problematic practices. And it's why we see, public sites shutting down commenting functions, and, the really poor practices of, sledging that happen in an online space. And I think that forms part of digital literacy, and it's something we have to teach and consume.
Well, those poor practices, I think, would be worthy of study and teaching as what not to do, which is very, very important. Eve, do you want to add to Cheryl's equally rich riposte?
Yes, that would be. We're happy to do that. First of all, on the notion of digital well-being, just to back up that point, that there is a tendency also in Europe to see, if you discuss digital well-being, to see it more in a kind of a negative approach. In relation to privacy, security, protection of data, there are a number of problems, of course, related to that. Also, cyberbullying, a very, very big issue, sexual cyberbullying, etc. So there are a number of key issues there which are very, very important. But obviously, digital well-being should also be a more positive concept as well. Especially in the learning context, also that it should emphasize also, confidence and self-confidence to be able to deal with digital technologies. And that actually brings me back to the framework we've been developing. If I can share it very briefly with you, which is called DigComp. It's a European framework for digital competence for citizens, where we actually defined and described what we believe in Europe are the most important competences related to being digital, meaning to be able to participate in our society. And it's a very broad kind of concept, and we emphasize five areas: being able to deal with information, being able to communicate and share with others, being able to collaborate, deal with your privacy and security issues, and also dealing with a number of problem-solving kind of items as well. So these are five areas, and among these five areas, we have defined 21 specific competences. And I will share the link in a second, or you may be already doing it, but I will share the link to the report in a second. We're developing now kind of a self-assessment instrument, which actually helps people, but also teachers and citizens, to see where are my strengths, but also where are my weaknesses, and then maybe look for a number of training opportunities. This model is also used in a number of European states to revise the curricula, so to help teachers to see, okay, we want to address digital literacy, but we don't know exactly what to focus on. So the model which we developed, which is based on a process of almost three years of research, and as Helen also, we published the version one in 2013, and now actually in June 2016, we released version 2.0. And that's not anecdotal, because actually I think one of the key messages from that point of view is also that digital literacy, or as we call it, digital competence, should also be regarded as something continuous, something which you have to continue to work on and to learn and to improve. It's not something that you learn once and then you think, I have it for the rest of my life. You know, it is something, it also includes also reflexive thinking. It's also thinking about what can I do, what I'm able to do in a digital society and with digital technologies. How can I make my life better using digital technologies? So it's also kind of a continuous reflection of digital technologies in our society.
So on the one hand, this is a form of what in the US we refer to obsessively as lifelong learning. And the other hand, it's what some call continuous improvement or continuous learning, in part because the world keeps expanding, the digital world keeps growing and developing. That's excellent, the three of you, the powerful trio of answers. Your answers have been very provocative. Everyone, if you haven't been looking, the chat box is rippling with panelists and the audience going back and forth. And I want to try to tie together a few of these questions and comments. So let me see if I can haul these into one spot. Tom, no last name, was asking about what we are doing with the digital world in terms of a university environment. He asked, have we really marginalized the antisocial elements or empowered them? Phil Long asked a related question, which Helen offered a beautiful answer to. And Phil asks about nationalism, that when we talk about digital citizenship in terms of digital well-being and digital literacy, we're really talking about nations. We haven't really been speaking about global citizenship. How do you reconcile this conflict? So let me bring these together and ask the panel if you can respond a bit. Do you think that we are producing a kind of, on the one hand, are we leading to a global citizenship world where everyone feels themselves to be members of the human race online, interacting in a positive way as a kind of global university, a global academy? Or are we heading to the opposite extreme, which is a balkanized world broken down by individual nations, perhaps by individual nation networks, where very, very bad behavior, bad practices we've talked about are actually on the rise? That question may be too long.
Well, Brian, I'll go just because I kind of had a bit of a tune-up for this by answering the question in the Q&A window. So I kind of But I'll answer it differently, because I think this idea of the internet as a global university was one that I was completely sold on, and I met so many of us were. You know, the peer review, commenting is kind of like peer review, isn't it? The breaking down of borders. You know, we were the MOOC is MOOCs are basically just kind of our fantasy common room when they work really well, and I don't think we realised several things there. I mean, you know, first of all, how intensely privileged we were, not just to have the barriers to those kind of conversations broken down for us, but to have the educational capital, the intellectual capital to start with, to really engage with them. So all the evidence I've looked about adult learning is that the more we bring those barriers to accessing high quality content, educational content, information, the more those barriers come down to almost zero, the more those of us who are already empowered and capitalized benefit. Yeah, we've got maybe, you know, the people who really benefit from MOOCs are people who've already got a first degree, who are pursuing passionately things they're interested in, who are thirsty for those kind of conversations and thirsty to be challenged. And yet we don't have to go very far down. You know, if you go to undergraduate level, actually, it's quite hard to get undergraduates to break out of their comfort bubble when it comes to exchanging online. It's not as though we're looking at a kind of subclass here. We're, you know, for most of us, it's actually hard to break out of our comfort zone, of our bubbles online. It's usually something that people do with the support of educators. It's not usually something that people do as a kind of, you know, to be challenged by an idea that's different from my own. It is not a safe space to be in, and most people only feel happy to do that when it's quite a held space. So I think that gives us a huge responsibility. And one of the things I say to teachers when I'm working with them is be really confident that you still have a role to play. Because for all the amazing conversations that are going on out there, your students probably won't join them unless you make them feel that they have something to say and that it's a safe space for them to say it. And that gives us back some of our importance as educators, that in some ways these amazing, we might feel a bit is being taken away from us by this access. I'll stop there so other people have things to say.
Well, back to empowering students. Eve, Cheryl, do you want to add to that?
If I may add to that, on the importance of teachers, teaching digital literacy, digital citizenship, we have some data which actually show, unfortunately, that we still have a long way to go. Also in terms of the competences and the knowledge and the skills of teachers to be able to really teach digital competence or digital literacy in a broad way, thus also taking into account things such as citizenship and identity and etiquette, etc. For example, we did. There was a survey done in 600 schools in Spain using the framework which we defined, which I explained before, and it shows that teachers themselves say that they are pretty good, pretty confident in being able to deal with information, critically assess information, share information, being able to communicate using digital technologies. But then when we go to the notion of citizenship, we see actually that many teachers admit that they are not so competent in using digital technologies to deal with citizenship, to explain citizenship, and actually to also make sure that their students are empowered using these tools to participate in society. So very low confidence of teachers to being able to do that. So I think there's a major job to be done also to continuously, train and support our teachers in education so that they also equipped and have the necessary skills and competences to be able to deal with citizenship, to be able to deal with privacy, security, and especially also identity. Because identity is also one of the competences in our framework, meaning that actually you need to know and understand what it means to have a digital identity, or let's say it properly, to have several digital identities. And there, for example, again, our teachers declare that they are not very confident dealing with these issues. So we have a long way to go from that angle.
So brilliant. I mean, when you say identity, do you mean personal identity? You know, my avatar, my presentation of self online and so forth?
Exactly. It's like the digital different identities and the meanings these have, which you portray using digital technologies, your Facebook, your Twitter, all your different kind of identities, but also your identity as a student and the way you behave as a student, but at the same time, your identity, the way as you behave as a friend, going out in the weekend, which, you know, are not necessarily are similar identities. but they all are exercised through digital technologies.
Right.
And we see that you know, young people, they seem to be very fluent in these, but they're not necessarily have the critical understanding and awareness what it actually means also for their identity of the and for their future, the way they portray themselves in digital environments.
We see the same thing in the US. I'm so glad that you brought us to the role of teachers and to thinking about the current state of digital literacy and where it is in the world. Let me just remind everybody that you have multiple ways of asking questions. The Q&A box has already had some fantastic questions from Mark, Tom, David, Phil Long, the women so far. I hope that changes. And the chat box is just buzzing along with comments at rapid speed. And we've had a few thoughts, a few resources from the Twitter world. So again, the hashtag is NMCHZ. We've had people drawing attention to digital well-being, to global literacy, and people have been sharing some of the great links. So I think that we can really take this in a few different directions, because we're hitting on a whole series of major, major themes. Let me take us back a couple of minutes. Helen and someone else was talking about data and algorithmic thinking. I wonder what this says about digital literacy going forward. On the one hand, should we be talking about having students learn more about coding, computational thinking, databases, and data manipulation? On the other hand, should we be really adding to them the critical, social, and theoretical tools necessary for thinking about what does it mean to live in a world increasingly driven by algorithmic logic, by software, by artificial intelligence? I'm thinking of part of Kathy O'Neill's wonderful recent book with the best title of 2017 called Weapons of Math Destruction, which is very critical about how we actually implement such. So what do you think? And I'm asking the panel about algorithmic thinking, but I'm also asking all the participants, what do you think about the role of digital literacy in responding to algorithms?
Brian, I'm really grateful that you threw that back to the participants here, because this for me is where disciplinary thinking becomes both really powerful but also limiting, because working mainly in further and higher education, I see digital literacy as being very, very multiple, and different disciplines and subject areas and different professions require different aspects to it. So I think for us to say everyone must learn coding and that's the only way to become algorithmically literate would be completely the wrong approach. But I do think we need to draw on the resources of many disciplines and expect that they will develop different kinds of capability in their students. So as you say, the kind of critical social the critical tools of looking at the consequences for groups in society if biased algorithms come to dominate some aspects of our social life, that would be somewhere in the social sciences. You know, the social psychology of how we participate differently when we have the relative anonymity of public of social media, that's for psychologists. How we design environments that perhaps are more welcoming, give a greater sense of belonging. That's a design discipline issue. You know, so coding is not the only way to become aware. And our goal is for students to become aware. But we are dealing with these complex changes that we really need to look across discipline boundaries to understand ourselves. So I think that simply saying go back to your disciplines and look through whatever digital lens your discipline gives you is a good answer, but it's not enough, because it's then also sharing that with people in other disciplines and subject areas as well. And that's why we need those examples, folks, from you participants. That's what we need to hear about. How do you do it in your discipline?
Oh, that's a great idea. Before you answer that, let me just celebrate two key points. One is the vitality of interdisciplinarity, that no one discipline, not computer science, not media studies, not sociology, not psychology, owns this question. But the other is that we must push back, we must contribute back. That in many ways, my understanding of digital literacy is that it is productive and participatory, and that we often miss that in our notion of literacy, including media and information literacy, that we must give back as well. Let me second Helen's question for the chat box. What do you guys see as your discipline's contribution to thinking about digital literacy, and in particular to algorithms and a world driven by data? And while you're thinking about that, let me give Cheryl and Eve a chance to take a whack at the big question.
Okay, maybe I can add something on the notion of computational thinking, but because at the level in Europe and at the level of ministries of education and many countries in Europe, they are now really indeed dealing with programming, coding, or some might call it computational thinking, and to introduce them in the curricula, like in the UK, for example, but in many other countries as well, in Finland, in Spain as well. So, and we did a little study on that, and I just shared already the link to the study to highlight just a couple of things. First of all, of course, the terms are being intermixed all the time. I mean, coding, programming, and computational thinking. While we would argue, based on the literature review we did, that actually computational thinking would include coding and programming, but it goes much more behind that. Computational thinking really means that you are able to use a computer algorithm to solve everyday problems, to solve your problems. So trying to learn to think as a computer to solve problems, which is, of course, a skill, I think, or competence, which goes much more behind programming or coding. But I think, on the other hand, already it's very very useful and very good that in many, many countries they are now revising the curricula and indeed more and more emphasizing the importance of learning to program, to introduce some coding. But again, it should not be regarded as a critical, as a technical skill only. I mean, you need to have the more critical kind of approach to it. And that's why we emphasize in Europe the notion of competences. Because a competence for us means knowledge, skills, and attitudes. And attitudes also introduces things such as motivation, such as critical thinking into the environment. So it's not just about learning to code, but it's much more about also understanding how we can use the power of computers to deal with everyday life issues.
So again, you come back to your theme of the positive discussion of this as well as the negative one. Very, very good. Very good. We've got links to the study you've mentioned in the chat box and on Twitter, by the way. Cheryl, do you want to take a crack at this?
Yes. I mean, I think one of the issues, I think there are a couple of different issues. One of them is I think what's going to set our students ahead is the ability to produce and contribute in the digital society, not just consume. I mean, I think that even the students with the poorest access can be consumers of the knowledge online, but to be actually able to engage in a way that's productive, I think is really a challenge. So I think this discussion around data and coding and understanding the digital world is really important. And the other side of that is, I know in education we talk a lot about learning analytics. It's a very big thing. I mean, in our sort of more technology oriented conferences, we want to bring this area of data analytics and learning analytics in. But I'm not sure that the average educator has any idea about how to use data meaningfully for teaching and learning. So if I bring it away from the more global orientated thing back to the what is data able to tell us about our students and ourselves, I just don't think people have that knowledge or awareness. I don't think people understand the digital footprints they leave behind. So it's a sort of a bit of a left, sort of a different type of an answer to the one that everyone else has given. But I think it's a lot that we need to think about. And I think data literacy is really important because we really need to help people understand for the issues around privacy and well-being, just what data is being collected by about them and what data they're leaving behind.
That's a lot to think about. The whole data world, maybe this is something that we need to return to as a subject of an entire program. We have quite, thank you so much, Cheryl and Eve, for answering and adding to what Helen was saying as well. We have a lot of questions that are popping up in the chat box covering a wide range of ground from algorithmic bias to differential education levels. And we have a new question from someone who is coyly described as user. He wants to know about different ways the states use the digital dimension. What about a state government's digital literacy as compared to public citizen or individual user literacy? Who is it that practices digital literacy and needs digital well-being? Oh, that's a fantastic question, coyly named user. Panelists, do you want to take a whack at this? What does it mean for a state to be digitally literate? Maybe Eve can lead off, being so closely represented with European states.
Oof, very good question. A very interesting question. Difficult question to deal with. So if you allow me, I would maybe pass on that question.
Okay, we can come back to that.
Pretty complicated kind of issue, and I'm sure Helen will have something significant to say about that one.
Oh, she's on it right now. Helen.
Well, I don't know about, significant, Eve, but I can. Eve is being too coy here because in the EU projects that I'm privileged to have a small role in, there's a really clear understanding that there are digital competencies of the citizen, but that as an individual, you can only go so far to develop them. So one of the projects I'm working on under Eve's guidance is to develop tools for organisations to also audit their own capability in the sense of what kind of environment do they provide for their individual members to thrive in, to develop their digital capability. We know that so much of this develops informally, for all that I've said about the role of teachers. And some of that informal development depends on the environment you're in. This policy environment, the technical environment, the sense of safety that you have. And so the EU explicitly recognises the limit of individual responsibility. And we've tried to start doing that a little bit with the framework I developed in the UK by having an organisational version of it. Now, that doesn't go up to the level of the state, but it does go up to the level of quite large organisations. And I think it does help to clarify that as educators, we're always thinking about building individual capital, aren't we?
Mm-hmm.
We want our students personally to benefit, to gain, to have resilience, to be able to thrive, to be able to deal with algorithmic bias if they encounter it, to have greater understanding and consciousness, to be able to participate. But we also have this broader responsibility, I think, to education in a broader sense about the very question you started with, Brian, the kind of society we want to live in and the kind of organisations we want to build around ourselves. And it's really important that we don't throw all of those responsibilities back on the person as though we can all bootstrap ourselves into a space of higher consciousness, because that simply isn't true. So I'm trying to answer for Eve a little bit and say that I think that he's doing himself a disservice here, because there's a really clear policy directive about this at the European level.
Well, there's also, thank you, and I appreciate your, trans-channel ventriloquism just then. We have in the chat box a recommendation for a book from a librarian, which we should expect. Angela asked us to consider Scott's book, Seeing Like a State. And I do want to pull that out, because that combines a couple of things that we're discussing here. It's very, very critical of states' abilities to actually use information well. So we have this interesting dynamic of, do we want states to provide digital services and to use digital technology to provide non-digital services, which has been a rising interest over the past decade, or do we see the state as problematic in that way? But Cheryl, did you want to jump on this as well?
Yes. I think one of the interesting things about that is how we're very focused on the student and the teacher, and then probably the youth, I think, at the moment. But the people we're sort of missing are the people that are kind of controlling what it is, the environments and the things that are happening. So I think it is an example. I'd just like to say that in the recent protests around fees in South Africa, we've seen some really different uses of the digital world from students and from management and from government. And it clearly shows that there is a different level of structure and agency in the digital environment. And so if we want to bring that back to the discussion around digital literacy, it suggests to me that sort of policymakers need to understand their audiences better, need to understand how to engage with people in the space that they're in. It's a bit like, when people say going down to the level of the child, you need to be able to find a common medium and, to sort of engage with. And I could see management emailing out sort of edicts and explanations, and students taking to Twitter and Facebook to voice frustrations and use images and that sort of thing. And there was a complete contradiction and disjuncture between the communication that was happening. And I think part of that was, I don't think each of the role players understood the different digital literacies of each other and how to find that kind of common ground. And I think that's something that I think we need to think about in this whole sort of thing about how we help. We have to understand the other in a different kind of way. And then we need to help policymakers understand what their role is in this. I mean, I suppose the only thing I can say as sort of a plug for a project I'm working on is that we're busy working on a resource called Digital Education Leadership. See, I can almost forget what my own project is called. But what Helen's involved in as an advisory group member of this, but it's an open education resource and curriculum. It's going to come out of the Commonwealth of Learning. And what it does is it actually wants to engage policymakers as well as teachers and students. And I think that's really powerful because what it's saying is we need to look at the area of digital education, digital literacy at a number of different levels. And it's still conceptual, but I'm hoping that once it comes out, we'll be able to open it up. Although I can't imagine what policymakers are going to want to sit down and do, you know, any type of online learning to understand this, but it's still something.
Well, thank you. I'm so glad you mentioned that. And if you have access, Cheryl, to the chat box, I just echoed your call to the Commonwealth of Learning. If you want to throw in a link to that wonderful project, or if you want to throw in a word or two about that, please feel free to use that in the chat box. We have a whole string of questions and even more readings of articles and books. I think we'll have a syllabus for an upper level graduate seminar in about 3 minutes if we keep going at this rate. Thank you, Lisa, for throwing that in. Again, ask a librarian and you get the best answers. Tom has some provocative questions both in the chat box and in the Q&A. I think you guys are going to want to come back and look after that when we're done. But I'd like to, if I can, start closing this up, not closing up the discussion, but shaping the conversation towards the next hour so people can take what we're talking about and take it home and bring it to their institutions. So thinking about data literacy, algorithmic thinking, digital well-being, digital citizenship, critical awareness, all of these, in 2018, what does all of that do to the role of teachers and educators? Is our job in education to empower students? Is our job to combine teaching the digital material skills along with the conceptual frameworks around that? Is our role to return to the roots of media literacy and help students become even more skeptical and critical? What does it mean to be a teacher, given all these topics we need to address?
Okay, Brian, great question. Just very briefly, maybe, because your question begs us to think a bit about the future of education and how, you know, the future, how education has to change, because obviously, if you look at the digital transformation of education, we are complaining still a lot that actually we see that education is still organized along industrial society kind of requirements, where information provision is, you know, the main, the dominant paradigm, and where there's very few place for interaction, for sharing, for peer learning. So there are now many, many studies already during the last years indicating actually that we need a shift in the educational paradigm, moving to, you know, from information sharing and knowledge to more learning the underlying skills that enables you to make sense of what you can find on the internet. Because information is there, but you have to be able to make sense of these things. Meaning also that teachers are becoming much more guides and orchestrators of learning rather than telling students what they have to know, but rather how they have to learn certain things which are important for them. So there are a lot of studies on that. I don't want to take too much time discussing that. But if I may abuse, now that I'm speaking anyway, to maybe highlight one element that has not yet been addressed, and that is, I think, also an important part of digital citizenship, and that is actually the citizen as a consumer, which you may like or not like, but consumer and consumerism is obviously very much part of our everyday lives as well. And just to argue that actually I think in the notion of citizenship, also that part could be important, that actually we'll have to educate people to become also digital consumers, and that they need to have the competences to do reliable, safe, and responsible consumption through digital technologies. Because obviously we know that there's a lot of manipulation also going on, where companies are very well placed to use social media to influence consumers, that's clear. And I think also we need to invest a lot also towards the future when everything becomes more digital, that consumers also need to understand how consumption works in a digital world. And to finalize on that, just to highlight that we actually also published a report on that, where we used the overall digital competence framework for citizens and applied it to consumers, to digital consumers. And I will provide a link to that study in the chat in a moment.
Thank you. Thank you. That's a great program for educators to follow. Cheryl, Helen, do you want to chime in?
Well, okay. So with 9 minutes to go, I'm going to disagree with Eve. I'm sorry, Eve. And you know, but I'm going to disagree a little bit about the first thing you said. And that was, I think the implication of the guide on the side kind of discourse that we have heard a great deal in the last 10 years is that a competence-based or competence-centered curriculum is what we need. And I think my own experience contradicts that to some extent. So I think these kind of capabilities that we're all agreeing in a very idealistic way need to be there in the curriculum. Students actually haven't signed up to become digital citizens. They've signed up to become engineers or designers or nurses or whatever they've signed up for. Our responsibility is to help them to understand that fulfilling those roles in a digital world has particular makes particular demands on them, and to prepare them for that. So I think when we try and integrate digital issues into the curriculum, we do it most successfully when we engage teachers and when we engage them in really thinking critically about how their discipline is changing and how to provide authentic, meaningful activities that meet the requirements we have of kind of critical thinking, digital engagement, media literacy, but that also meet the requirements of their expertise and the things that their students have signed up to do. Now, I know that's not exactly what Eve is saying, but I'm just slightly overreacting to it because I think there has been a tendency that these things can be taught, you know, separate. Some separate module can arrive and be plugged in, or some separate teacher who's got this special digital know-how can arrive and parachute into the classroom and make everything okay. And I'm afraid it's harder than that. It's about all of us taking responsibility for what our subject area means, how it's changing, how the methods are changing, how the context is changing, how we can provide a subject specialist lens on the digital world that we were talking about earlier. And that's difficult and it's complicated, and it requires us to be in communication with our colleagues about what it means and sharing our practice and our examples and being very confident that we might not always get it right. So I think if I had a kind of pedagogic paradigm that I would want to bring in here, it wouldn't actually be competence-based. It would be critical pedagogy, where we go forward with our students in a state of unknowing about exactly the right way to teach them or to help them to develop, but openness to what might happen in the encounter. And I think their digital know-how challenges our subject know-how in many ways, and that's a challenge, if we can, that we should try to welcome.
Thank you, Helen. That's another chart. I don't think you guys differ much. That's another guide for where educators should be going. We had some more opposition from people in that, where Phil wanted you to think about scarcity versus abundance. But before we pile on Eve, let's give Cheryl a chance to join in.
I mean, I think the critical is a very nice way to end off. I'm also looking at the time, and I see we have 6 minutes left now as well. We have a very lovely facilitator that keeps telling the panelists where we're at with things. So thanks, Gordon. I mean, I think the challenge for us is to help people think critically. I really do. I think it's about, and in fact, we've had a lot of people in the chat using the word critical. Whatever type of literacy we're trying to embed and enable in people, they need to be critical. We need to be critically information literate, critically media literate. We need to help our students think critically and our teachers think critically about the role of technology. Technology is not always the answer. And so it is about why do we need it? When do we need it? Who needs it? What are the, you know, what are the circumstances and the context? So I think, you know, whilst we're immersed in it and it's never going to disappear and we know it's part of our life, I think it is, I think I like the idea of ending with the notion of criticality sort of forefront in our minds. So I'm going to leave it at that for me.
Criticality, teach students to be thinkers. This is fantastic. We are really at the end of the session, and we've covered an awful lot of ground. There's been some interesting discussion on Twitter, a whole questions in the Q&A box, and I want to, there a couple of meta questions. Will there be a chat transcript available? Yes. Will the Q&A be available afterwards? Yes. A couple of themes that came up in the chat box. One is that there's a lot of discussion about politics. Lisa asked if we should think that all classes are really about consumption, about capitalism, for example. Had some string of questions and comments about what happens to information when it is less scarce and more abundant. At one point, Tom said information is cheap now. Books are easy. Manifestos are easy. And yet we still live in a world of physical scarcity. We have quite a lot to look at there. Let me just try and wrap this up if I can. There's a lot here. We have been talking about differential access to information and questions of variable social capacity. We hinted at two broad visions of the world going forward, one where the world is a kind of good transnational university, where, as far as we have conversations that are productive, that race across national boundaries. And then we have a version of the balkanized, where bad practice use and bubbles rise up. We also have consumption, participation, and production again, to be. Much of that is consumption. How much in the 20th century's notions of consumerism? Much of it is based on participation, say through social media, production of actually making more stuff. Tom offers an American perspective, a wonderful phrase. He says, liberal arts, so this is the liberal arts education, drawing on the Latin artis liberalis, the interdisciplinary, undergraduate-focused, learner-focused way of teaching and learning. Liberal arts are a makerspace for rational thought, ideas, and dreams. I love how this connects with Cheryl was saying about reality and Eve's idea of being positive as well and skeptical as all this can do. And then we have Helen's charge to us as teachers to really, in many ways, rethink education beyond the 1990s guide in the side, sage in the stage, but towards what it really means to live in a digital world with all its complexities, challenges, and possibilities. There's a lot here. We've been carrying on this conversation for a while. We plan to continue it through social media. And if you like, let us know if you want more possible programs to do. NMC is going to share the chat box and the Q&A box, as well as recording this on YouTube. And I can just storify the Twitter conversation right now. Before I pass the conch over to them, let me just thank our splendid panelists who have come from all over the world. Let me thank Eve, and we thank Helen, and we thank Cheryl for deeply, deeply thoughtful your comments and questions. The benefit from your experience and the participants who have been fantastic, very, very generous with your thoughts, your pushback, and your contributions. Let me pass the talk over to Sam. Sam?
Wow. What an enriching discussion. My mind is actually spinning, and no, not just because it's 60 degrees here in Chicago in February. But that was just really enriching. I learned a lot from everyone. I hope the audience did too. I learned a lot from you too, audience. Great questions. I want to personally thank, on behalf of the NMC, Brian for being an excellent moderator. Cheryl, Helen, and Eve, thank you so much for your time and your insights today. As Brian noted, the webinar has been recorded. We will be distributing it as a YouTube video very soon. as well as the chat and Q&A archives. So you will be, you know, getting those to rewatch and relive every moment. So that's all for today, but we hope that you'll register and tune in to next week's Beyond the Horizon. The subject is financial aid for competency-based education. This is a really a can't-miss event because competency-based education, or CBE, is really one of the hottest and emerging learning approaches out there today. But one of the facets of it that's not always considered is how it could be transferred to credit hours and how students can receive financial aid for it. So lots to think about. If you're new to CBE, this is especially a great webinar for you to join. You can learn more and register at nmc.org/events. Thank you again so much to Brian and all of our panelists and this lovely audience. Until next week, thank you and take care.